Mastication involves the reduction of vegetation by grinding, shredding, or chopping. When done properly, mastication treatments reduce fire risk and severity through the rearrangement of canopy, ladder, and surface fuels. However, it's important to note that in most mastication treatments, the biomass stays on site, so the fuel loading is not reduced, just reconfigured. There are many different types of mastication equipment, and a full description is beyond the scope of this video. However, at a basic level, mastication machines can be categorized as either horizontal shaft, otherwise known as drum masticators, or vertical shaft, also known as rotary disc masticators. The heads can be mounted on a variety of vehicles, including the booms of tracked vehicles such as feller bunchers, or masticating heads can be integrated into the motor body of rubber-tired loading-type vehicles such as skidders. Increasingly, mastication is used on sites in which it is difficult to use prescribed fire, either due to risk of escape, smoke concerns, or the presence of homes.
The way that we use mastication here in the Southwest, it's to rearrange the fuel profile to make it less hazardous. We target mostly in those urban interface areas, which we have a lot of, to create buffer zones, I think is where it makes the most sense, or areas where there's going to be a lot of sensitivity for smoke, where we don't want to put a lot of smoke in the air. So right behind a subdivision where we've done some treatment or where we need to do some treatments.
But it's just one of those tools that we like to use that'll allow us to reduce the fuel condition. It doesn't alleviate the fuel loading, but it turns it into a condition that's less conducive to rapid fire spread. You know, it's beneficial to put that biomass down on the ground. It helps retain moisture in the ground because you're basically not having the ground exposed to direct sunlight. There's, you know, the biomass there is keeping some of the moisture in it. It's also a good environment for organisms and insects and other beneficial life forms to, you know, for the soil.
Yeah, we're standing here in an area called Acid Canyon. We are almost in the center of the town of Los Alamos. This canyon here is, again, is open space, it's parkland, and it's surrounded by neighborhoods. What this treatment called for in here was the harvest of the trees down to 4 inches in diameter. The trees were limbed and topped at 4 inches in diameter, and anything less than 4 inches in diameter was masticated. So what we're learning is that mastication works and is a good treatment, but much of it depends upon what the thickness of the residual masticated layer is. And here you can see that there's very little evidence of masticated material. The grasses have come up. The amount of material that was masticated was such that we didn't end up with any sort of a carpet in here. It was very dispersed, this is much more of a desirable effect.
The true test of any fuel treatment is how it influences fire behavior, slowing the rate of spread, reducing the potential for crown fire, and mitigating fire severity. Fire and land managers report that under the right conditions, mastication treatments have a positive influence on fire behavior.
In 2011, we had the Donaldson fire, and when it burned from private land and got onto the Ranger District, it burned onto over 1,000 acres that had been masticated in the past, several years prior. And since then, oak brush had kind of come up in the openings. Still had pinyon and juniper leaf trees and leaf clumps. Resources mostly utilized that, and the Forest Service roads that were widened with dozers to do burnouts. And it seemed very effective for control line. And you go back and the fire effects were fairly beneficial to the area that they burned out that was masticated.
You know, from what I've seen on normal fires that go into these masticated areas, they're easier to pick up, whether you're using hand crews and engines or dozers to put in containment lines. They seem to be a little easier to pick up because the chance of torching and getting an active crown fire are very little, if any.
Despite these benefits, the extreme burning conditions experienced across the Southwest over the past couple of years have also raised questions about the effectiveness of mastication treatments.
Last year, we were on the Horseshoe 2 fire in Arizona, and we did some burning through a mastication project. You know, it was as intense as fire running through the crowns of PJ in a windy day. It ran extremely fast through the mastication, just like it would grass, but with about 10 times the intensity that you would have in a grass fire. It does remove it from the crowns and puts it back on the ground, but you wouldn't be able to go on a direct attack with personnel. You'd have to still use mechanical equipment.
In the aftermath of the 2000 Cerro Grande fire, mastication treatments were implemented in and around the community of Los Alamos and the Los Alamos National Laboratory. Some of these treatments were tested in the 2011 Los Conchas fire.
This treatment was done in about 1998 on my right-hand side here. This was thinned, the material was piled, and it was burned. In 2000, when the Cerro Grande fire was threatening the town and the laboratory, suppression forces burned off of the highway over here to stop the head of the Cerro Grande fire. Following the Cerro Grande fire, the Forest Service then came in and we planned and implemented a thinning on the Forest Service side of this, over here to my left, over here to this portion here. And this was implemented in about 2004. And what we did is took about 300 trees of the acre, we took it down to about 40 to 60 trees of the acre. But the residual chip depth in here, because of the amount of biomass and the number and the size of trees that we masticated, the chip depth in here was pretty appreciable. It was probably 2 to 3 inches, and it was relatively continuous. During the Las Conchas, again, we were faced with the same situation. The fire was coming up from over on top of this ridge, and there was a burnout operation along the road here. The difference being is that the area where that had seen prior treatment, thinning and burning, but had not been masticated, the majority of trees lived. There's almost a line down here between the masticated portion, or the area that was masticated in after the Cerro Grande fire, and the area that was cut before the Cerro Grande fire. So what this treatment demonstrated is, again, is this masticated area over in here burned with some pretty high intensities and certainly some high severities. You know, that chip layer under extremely dry conditions all becomes available to burn. And in this particular instance in here, you know, we're looking at probably, you know, 98% mortality. It didn't crown out, the fire stayed on the ground, it didn't crown out, but the severity in here was just as great, it killed everything.
Mastication can also result in unintended consequences. Concentrating fuels on the ground can negatively impact soils and promote invasive species.
Or just in general, that to expect, you know, maybe lower flame lengths, but it cranks out a lot of BTUs and holds it close to the ground, so very easy chance for sterilizing your soil and also cooking the roots of your leaf trees.
Yeah, one of the challenges when you have a big depth or chip depth from a masticated area is when you get a fire rolling through there, the amount of time that heat is sitting on the soil, it's kind of like pile burning, could have a negative effect to the soil. You could actually damage the soil.
The other thing that we may be seeing on some of our sites is that also mastication might be encouraging exotic species. When you have a layer of masticated material that acts like a pretty effective mulch, many of your native species seem to have a hard time coming up through that. In some of our locations, what we're seeing is that some of the exotics, like bull thistle, seem to thrive under that kind of condition.
Decisions related to fuels management always involve important trade-offs in terms of positive and negative ecological impacts and in promoting and mitigating certain fire behaviors. According to land managers, mastication is no different in this regard and should be implemented only with close communication with all resource specialists.
You know, it's one of those treatments that it depends. It's not universal. It's not good for every place. And it's not good for every circumstance and every stand condition. And we need to be thinking about what the implications are when we try it. We need to have a little bit more knowledge about where it might work and where it might not, where it might be a benefit, and where we may be making things worse.
Researchers have confirmed what many land managers have observed. Mastication may be more effective in moderating fire behavior than reducing tree mortality. However, research is also showing that treating masticated fuels with prescribed fire could potentially improve the resilience of stands to fire. Check out the Southwest Fire Science Consortium publications for more information on science, management, and practitioner knowledge regarding mastication treatments.